But little did we know that the Irish had a treacherous plan. Behind each of the 100 pillars that held the vast roof of that giant house, they had placed a peg. From each peg, they hung a bag, and within each bag was a fully armed warrior. I was told of this treacherous plan many years later, and just as Gwawl had been beaten within the bag in the court of Hefeith Hen many years before, so the darkness and womb-like quality of the bag once more enters our story. As fate befell, the first person to enter the house was Evnissian, Bran's troublesome half-brother. He cast his eyes about, and as he did so, he caught sight of the bags hanging from the pillars. He walked to one of the bags. "What is in this bag?" he asked. From within, a voice spoke.
"Flour, friend,"
came the reply. Evnissian poked the bag and felt the body within. He passed his hands across the outside of the bag until he felt a man's head. Evnissian smiled, and he squeezed that head until he could feel his fingers sinking into the brain as the bone of the skull was crushed in his grip. He left that one, placing his hands upon the next. "What have we here?" he asked.
"Flower, friend,"
came the reply. Evnissian played that same game with every man, and soon there was but one left. "What have we here?" he asked.
"Flower, friend,"
came the reply, and thus for the last time did he feel the head of the man within. He squeezed, just as he had with the others, but this time he felt armour upon the warrior's head. Evnissian did not let go until he had killed him. 100 dead warriors surrounded him. Evnissian smiled and sung this englyn. "In this bag there is flower of a kind. Conquerors, defenders, descenders to the grind. Facing fighting men, ready for the hour." Then the two armies entered the house of Bran. The men of Ireland on one side and we all sat on the other. Peace was proclaimed and Gwern was invested with the kingship of Ireland. After peace was made, Bran called to Gwern, who came to him. He then went to Manawydan, and all of us who saw him in that great house loved him. Nissian, son of Aeroswith, beckoned him, and the boy went to him with grace and enthusiasm. Then spoke Evnissian. "Why does the boy, my nephew and my sister's son, not come to me? Even if on this day he were not invested as king, I would like to make friends with him." Bran smiled at his half-brother. "Let him go gladly." And the boy cheerfully went to his uncle. I was there in the house that day. I saw what happened next. And even now it sometimes fills my dreams with nightmares. We knew Evnissian was cruel, but none of us could have imagined what he was to do next. Gwern, the young boy, hugged his uncle and Evnissian's gaze fell upon us all gathered there. I saw him whisper to himself and to the ear of his nephew, "I declare to the gods, this outrage I shall now commit is one no one here would ever expect." He stood up, taking the boy by his feet, and in one movement, before any of us had the chance to respond, he hurled the boy head first into the fire. I heard Gwern's cries of agony. I heard Branwen scream when she saw her son burning before her. And she tried to jump into the fire to save him, but Bran seized her with one hand, for it was too late. The boy was already dead. With his other hand, Bran seized his shield. Then everyone in the house leapt up, and there was the greatest commotion and uproar ever heard in one house as each side took up arms. Then Morthuid Tachlion said,
"Hounds of Gwern, beware Morthuid Tachlion."
As we all went for our weapons, Bran held Branwen between his shield and his shoulder. The battle was brutal. All battle is brutal. But this one had erupted from a moment of such joy that once more by the actions of Evnissian had turned from peace to hatred. There was such bloodshed on both sides that first day. But after the battle had subsided, we saw the Irish begin to kindle a fire beneath the cauldron of rebirth. We watched as they loaded their dead into the cauldron until it was overflowing with corpses. The next day, their ranks were filled with those reborn warriors. They stood amongst the ranks of the living in silence, eyes showing no fear, for they had all seen the other world. They yearned to tell of where they had been, but just as a newborn baby can only cry and speak no understood words, so those warriors too stood unable to speak, but fully able to fight. The day's battle was as bloody as before, with countless dead on both sides. As evening fell that dreadful day, I saw movement on the battlefield. It was Evnissian. He was walking amongst the dead in tears. In tears. He was the cause of this mountain of dead men from the Island of the Mighty. Had some regret fallen upon him? I watched as he slowly laid down among the Irish dead warriors. Two Irish men began to collect their dead, to take them once more to the cauldron of rebirth. And they took Evnissian with them. Each warrior was placed within, and I saw Evnissian tumble into that void within the ranks of the Irish dead. The fire was kindled, and it lit up the darkened night sky. But then there was a great explosion, and the cauldron split into four pieces. The Irish dead poured out, still and unmoving. Somehow, the cauldron had been destroyed. The battle was eventually won by the warriors of the Island of the Mighty. But there was no real victory that day. In the end, only seven of us escaped with our lives. Bran himself was wounded in the foot by a poisoned spear. The seven men who escaped were Manawydan, Glivai, son of Taran, Anok, Gravai, son of Miriel, Helin, son of Gwyn, myself, and a young bard by the name of Taliesin. I walked to the shattered remains of the Cauldron of Rebirth. It felt as if some age was coming to an end and a new one was about to begin. It was there that I saw the body of Evnissian among the Irish dead. He too lay still. His hands and feet were bruised and burned. In my mind, I saw him within the cauldron, stretching out his arms and legs and pushing with all of his strength. As the cauldron broke into four pieces, so Evnissian's heart had broken. He had given his life to save us. Was this Evnissian's redemption? Was that enough after all he had done? I guess only time will tell. Bran had been mortally wounded. The poison was already coursing through his veins, and he was weakening fast. He ordered us to cut off his head and take it to the White Mount in London, there to bury it, facing outwards towards the Channel Sea. "And it will take you a long time," he said. "You will feast in Harlech for 7 years, and you will find my head to be as good company as it ever was when it was on me. Then you must go to Gwales in Pembrokeshire for 80 years. So long as the door towards Aber Henfelin and Cornwall remains closed, you can remain there, and my head will not decay. But as soon as one of you opens that door, you must then make for London and bury my head. Let us go now, across the sea." We cut off Bran's head, and the seven of us, with Branwen as the eighth, set out back to the Island of the Mighty. This battle will be remembered always. It was the young bard who spoke, Taliesin. If you are a bard well versed in story and song, "I am sure it will," I replied. Taliesin smiled. "I have much of which to tell, with more to come. And you, Pryderi, your tale is not yet over." He looked out to sea. "I feel that this will not be the final time I return in a ship with none but seven survivors.